Welcome, absolutely welcome, and you know, wholehearted thank you for those of you who stayed from the last session. What an incredible session! For those of you who were not there, we talked about how there's a book and a podcast in every single one of us, and I really encourage you to go and watch the video of that particular event. It was really, really incredible. We had great speakers. So now let's get started. I see Vriti just came into the room. We're going to talk about how to design and mint an NFT. So we've been on this journey together since January, for all of us here in the community, talking about metaverse and NFTs, and we set up our first wallets and, you know, all kinds of exciting stuff, because as you all know, coming up in the last quarter, we are about to drop our first utility NFT project with all of you mentors in our community, right? You're going to hear all kinds of stuff about it. I promised you by June. June is just next week. It's just a couple more days away, and you're going to learn all about it. So as part of that journey, we have three exciting speakers today working on completely different projects. We have Ian, we have Vriti, and we have Shylesh. And I can't wait for you to meet them and hear about the stuff that they're working on. A little bit about Shylesh. So Shylesh is working on a gaming project for all the cricket fans in here, or any of the sport fans. His project is so dope. So I can't wait for him to share that about you. Shylesh is based in India. We then have Vriti. So Vriti was actually part of a Transcend community that I'm also a part of. We're both fellows of the Transcend community, and she's working on an incredible education project involving NFTs. So Vriti, if you can wave to everybody so they can see who you are. And then we have Ian, and Ian helps his clients, you know, create NFTs. So Ian is kind of going to give us a, you know, kind of like a broad scope of, you know, projects, maybe some interesting projects he's working on with his clients about NFTs. So I'm going to ask our host, so you get to know them, Vriti. Yes, I can see. Yeah, we're excited to meet you too. I'm going to ask each one of our co-hosts to answer this question, so we get a feel for who they are as individuals. So maybe Vriti, you can take this one first. What are some of your favorite NFT designs out there right now, and why?
Great. So first I want to ask a question. What do we know about NFTs? Do we think NFTs are just artwork? And Sallyann, is that the basic sort of focus of this conversation, or are we expanding it to be?
We're expanding it. So our audience actually knows. We did use cases of NFTs last month. So everybody actually knows.
So this is a really interesting and layered question, because you could talk about the design of artwork, or you could talk about the design of an NFT asset within like a smart contract or something like that, and what an NFT can actually do. And so I can talk very briefly about both of them. So in terms of designs, my favorite NFT designs are the ones that are really different. The things that you don't find in daily artwork, the things that are just like kind of odd and silly. One of my favorite projects is called Non-Fungible Fungi. And it's a really silly art project. It's basically these mushrooms that are 3D, and they're all like magical looking. They don't have faces, and they're just sort of like walking in a loop. And it's just like really delightful when you look at it. It's just like really fun to look at. And it's not flat art. It's actually 3D, and it's really fun. So I would say like anything that's like really delightful. There's another art project where there's each NFT is a different sound. And when you collect different NFTs, you can put those sounds together to make, you know, a set of music or a set of like, you know, tones that, you know, sound different based on which NFTs in the collection you have, which is really cool too. So there's a lot of these sort of like really interesting things. And then on the other side, which is like NFT designs, I would say like the more utility they have, the better they are. There are some NFTs out there that are flip projects that will that people will buy because they'll have a famous artist, or they'll have a lot of money behind it, or they'll have some sort of like, you know, sort of superficial trend behind it. But the truth is that the NFTs that have real utility, the ones that provide I'm some sort of, you know, utility for the member or the holder, whether it's a membership to something or it's a free tickets to something or it's merchandise or it's access to spaces that you might not have before. Those are the ones that are really worth a lot. And then you can also talk about micro-credentials, all that kind of stuff. But yeah.
Yeah. I love that answer. And I love that answer because you are correct. Most people, when you hear the word design, they immediately thought about the physical design. You know, so I love that. Hold on. You have to be an educator to kind of do that. That was awesome, Vriti. Yay for educators. All right. What about you, Shylesh? What is some of your favorite NFT designs and why?
Hi guys.
Yes.
So I see NFT as a utility. So I normally prefer NFTs which is linked to a game. So I like Zedrun. Zedrun is basically a horse racing game where you can breed your own horses, you can trade your horses, you can put them in the stable and then upgrade them and then race them after a while once they're upgraded. So that's one NFT. And the second one is Axie Infinity. Kind of blew up in the last couple of months. They had their first token, which kind of got broke. And then they had another token. And then they right now, they have four different types of cryptocurrencies in the game. So these two I would rate them the topmost NFT projects, which I like. And then followed by, like say, other just artwork kind of a project, which is your CryptoKongz and your Board Ape Yacht Club. So these two, I would say I would rate them the least because they don't have any utility to them. But I would say Board Ape Yacht Club is coming up with something cool. They're launching their own cryptocurrency which is also going parabolic. So why not? They're trying to get something like a utility added to their digital artwork. So.
Very cool. Very cool. And I'm glad that you weren't, you know, kind of, we all kind of hear when we hear about NFTs, those are the first two we hear about, right? So I'm glad that you mentioned it and you mentioned in terms of the utility. And what about you, Ian? What are some of your favorite NFT designs and why?
Hey, guys. What are my favorites? I can't really say that I have a lot of favorites, but as an artist, one of the things you find yourself doing is mimicking an artwork, and I found myself mimicking one of the artwork called Invisible Friends. Now I know it's very popular, this collection, but I like it for a different reason in that I come from an animator's background, and I like the fact that they were able to tell a story in many different variations by not even having a character on screen, because there was no character, there was just movement being implied. And I like the way that that story could be told in many different dimensions. So one of the projects that I have in mind is to do something along the lines of Invisible Friends. So that's how I know it's one of my favorites, not by thinking about it a lot, by just by thinking about it from an artistic point of view.
Wow. Thank you for sharing that, Ian. And for the audience here, I mean, most of us, when we, I don't know about you, you know, I'm by no means an expert in NFT, but I think we just got in our first question a lot of schooling about all the different kinds of NFTs that are out there and how they're not flat and how they're not static and how they're interesting and how they are dynamic and there are movement and there is, wow. Like I can go now. Like I learned all kinds of stuff. All right. What is your least favorite design and why? Vriti, I'm going to start with you. What is an NFT like you just don't like? Like, you know, you just don't understand it.
I'm not a huge fan of NFT art. Just the ones that are sort of like, there's a lot of hype behind it, but there's no beauty to the art. There's no dynamicism to the art. And there's also no utility. I would say that, so I think Board Ape Yacht Club is actually a great example. The artwork itself is fine. It's like, it's nice, right? Like it's a nicely illustrated thing. And the reason it's so popular is because there was a huge, very OG team behind it when it first got started. And they were trying to think about, like, you know, what the utility could be, but they hadn't had any utility as part of it when they actually launched it. And now it's becoming this really popular thing because it was one of the sort of original ones. But if you look at the actual artwork and if you actually look at what the utility started off at, it's not that big of a deal. And like that kind of project would not fly today. But the reason it did fly because it was very early on and it was novel at the time. And so I would say, like, right now there are people that think that they can launch NFT projects and be really great at it and make a lot of money. And the truth is, it is not easy at all. It is really difficult. Marketing it is really hard. Building a community is really hard. And the NFTs that, you know, just sort of like put out some sort of like basic flat artwork expecting to explode never do. And if they do explode because they've got a celebrity behind them or something like that, oftentimes you get rugged, which is like you just sort of like, you know, the project loses steam and you actually lose your money. And so I would say, you know, if I'm evaluating my favorite designs or my favorite, like, you know, utility of an NFT, I look at three things. I either look at who is part of the project. Is it a reputable team, a reputable artist, a reputable, you know, backer, something like that? Is there a community behind it, a substantial community that is active, not just like there's 10,000 people in Discord because those mostly could be bots, or 50,000 people on Twitter because those could be bots too. But what is the engagement? Are people actually messaging each other? Are people actually making comments about things, stuff like that? And then the third is utility. Like, what is this NFT going to provide me? And have they actually done anything yet? There are a lot of NFTs out there, a lot of projects out there that will have these beautiful roadmaps on their website. And they'll say, you know, we'll do this next month and this next month and that next, and none of it ever happens. So you have to look, like, have they done anything yet that is on their roadmap? Because most of those things can be done with $0 and they don't need $1 million to open a community or to, you know, have a workshop like you're having right now. Right. Yeah. So I would say that's how I look at my my favorite designs.
Perfect. I love that. What about you, Ian? What is your least favorite and why? You know, and I know you're looking at it from a designer animator perspective. So I have different perspectives here, which I love. What about you? Tell me, Ian.
My answer is going to be very similar to my favorite. I don't really have a least favorite because in honesty, if I have a least favorite, I already forgot what it was. You know, I'm not really thinking about anything.
You already, so that's how busy the space is. You can't even, you only have brain space for the ones you like. I love that answer. All right, what that awesome answer, Ian.
So it's also an artistic thing too, because you see, the way an artist thinks is not the way a normal person would think. For instance, if you look at music, most people think that beauty in music is among the notes that you're playing. But if you ask Beethoven, what's the beauty of music? He would tell you that the beauty of music is in the spaces of the notes that you play. It's not the notes you play, but the spaces between. And as an artist, for me, the way I look at art is very different. And so when I look at an art piece, I'm not thinking about who likes it or who don't like it. I'm looking at the way that the artist was trying to express something, even if it's an computer generated something. Like, there is still some part of the program was sold inside of the coding that's trying to come out. And so no matter if the piece is absolutely ugly, there is still something there that I can take from it and use in my artwork. And the rest of it, I just forget.
I love that answer, Ian. And you're correct. Spoken like a true artist, right? Spoken like a true artist. There's beauty in it for somebody. What about you, Shylesh? What about your, what is your least favorite design and why? And then we'll move on really quickly to each of your projects.
Yeah. So a couple of months back, there was a project called MFS. So it's like just a stick figure. I would say nothing much of an artwork though, but it got really famous. And then once it got famous, there was a huge community following happening. And then they had a huge Discord channel, and then people kind of promoted this artwork, and it was trending for a while. So a project like that, I would see like a rug pull, which doesn't have any utility to it. Say from a product designer's perspective, I always see value in an artwork. Say if an artwork doesn't have any value to it or a utility to it, I would value it like very, like almost as low as possible. So I also see NFTs as an investment. So basically, if I don't see a value, or if I kind of get a gist that this might be a rug pull, then obviously I would bail from the project. So I would, there is no such project I would want to pinpoint. That there are plenty of projects, almost 98% of all the NFT projects are going to fail in the next couple of months. So just hoping that people who are investing in NFTs, they don't get disheartened by what's happening in the market. So
okay, that's so utility is key for you. Okay, I love that. Thank you. Like, that's valid. Now, I want you guys to hear about the exciting projects everyone is up to. So, Vriti, why don't you start? Why don't you share for the next, you guys have about 10 minutes each, share about your project that either you have launched, you're in the process of launching, your thought process behind it, design, all of the things for anybody here right now who is thinking, I want to launch an NFT. Why don't you share what that roadmap looks like and what you're up to?
Sure. Yeah. Launching an NFT project is pretty complicated, unfortunately. You would think it's easy. I'll share my screen in a second so that you guys can see our project. So the way, there are a few things that you want to think about when you're launching an NFT project. One is, what is the purpose of launching this project? Is it just to generate treasury funds for your project? Is it to create a community and to grow a community? Is it to provide value in some sort of way that, like, you know, is like a ticket or a credential or a transcript or something like that? So you have to figure out what your utility is. And then you have to figure out, well, what does this look like? You know, what does the artwork look like? You know, whether it's 2D, 3D, is it animated, is not animated? What is the sort of, like, you know, manifestation of this thing that you want to create? And the third thing is a smart contract. So what kind of, what kind of rules do you want to set for this NFT? Who gets to buy it? When do they get to buy it? You know, what is the price of it? How does the royalties work? You know, are there anything else that, any other sort of like airdrops that people get from the contract? Who does the money go to? Like, the smart contract is a pretty complicated thing that you have to get a developer for if you want to do it right. Especially if you want to make sure that the gas fees are optimized for different blockchains, stuff like that. And then which blockchain you want to put it on. Do you want to put it on Ethereum? Do you want to put it on Polygon? Do you want to put it on Solana? Like, you have to figure that out too. And then you have to figure out, how do you want to market this? And do you want to build a community? So do you want to market this through your, you know, social media channels? Do you want to create a marketing campaign? Do you want it to be in person? Do you want it to be virtual? And then how do you want to create a community around this? What is the purpose of the community? Will the community persist after your NFT launches? All that kind of stuff. So there's like a huge sort of spectrum of things that you have to do and a huge team that you have to assemble to do this. So our NFT is actually part of our DAO. Sally Ann, have you guys talked about DAOs yet?
We have.
Okay, great. So our DAO is the first DAO for educators, by educators, owned by educators. And the purpose of the DAO is we're trying to educate educators on Web3, because if everybody on the planet that has the most money is spending all of their money on Web3, that means that the workforce is going to be soon controlled by Web3. And if the workforce is going to be controlled by Web3, then we have to have our students ready for it. And to have our students ready for it, our educators have to be ready. So we basically want educators to be multipliers of Web3 knowledge. And so we're educating educators, and it's traditional educators, non-traditional educators, anyone who identifies as an educator. And so our NFT is basically going to help us build the treasury and the community for our DAO. Our NFT is called Ed3 Educator. And an Ed3 Educator is basically an educator who is, is the way that Web3 is the evolution of the web, Ed3 is the evolution of education. And so this is how we thought about our NFT. First of all, 60% of our of our NFTs are female, because 60% of global educators across K-20 are self-identified female. Every layer and asset is created from scratch, because we wanted to make sure that there are no copyright issues, things like that. Educators, you know, hold this magic of knowledge and pedagogy. So we actually represented that with an item that's floating between their hands that could be literal or metaphorical, that represents what they can actually teach. And then the backgrounds are really chaotic and really sort of like very vibrant. because we know educators are constantly placed in really difficult situations and they always have to adapt. So their outerwear is actually adapting to the background. So our NFTs, they're, you know, a variety of NFTs that are 3D. They're not 3D in terms of like they're like 3D designed, and we have some rare ones and some you know, general ones. And the utility of our NFT is that it's going to power the Ed3 DAO, as well as what we call the Eduverse, which is a metaverse environment for educators. And it's a free metaverse environment for educators. It's a place where educators from around the world can gather. And it's actually already built. So we're actually going to release it in a couple of days and basically allow educators to come together on a global level so that they can solve problems, share resources, and have that community that they get at conferences, but every day. And then the NFT itself comes with giftable assets. So if you're not an educator, you can actually get an educator to learn about Web3 by keeping the NFT for yourself, but you can actually gift them a ticket to the conference. We have an Ed3 certification program that Coinbase has just funded. And so you can actually give that certification to an educator and they can learn all about Web3 and empower themselves, and social tokens to our Ed3 DAO. And so that's sort of how we thought about our NFT. And the purpose is really that education has been stagnant for a really long time. And we want to make sure that we're helping educators evolve. And so I'll throw our Discord link into the chat. If you guys want to join, you can pop in. And if anyone's based in New York, is anyone based in New York? I don't know if they are. We have an event during NFT NYC. I'm actually speaking at NFT NYC. And we've got a launch party on June 21st. So if you're going to be there, then you should definitely come.
And when are you launching these NFTs, if any of us are interested?
So June 20th is the date for the launch. However, we might actually do a pre-launch 1 week prior to that. And it's all sort of like based on all the parties that we want to have in New York City to sort of like commemorate this. You know, it's going to be this project is a little bit historic because it's the first NFT made for educators by educators to empower educators. Most NFTs aren't sort of like in the education space because education, you might all know, is pretty stagnant. And, you know, educators right now aren't there yet. But as an educator myself, we're basically trying to get as many educators into that place as possible. So yeah, so we've just gotten a partnership and a grant from Coinbase to move forward on our certification programs. And we're really excited to basically educate the first 1 million educators on Web3. So yeah, so I hope you all... I hope you all will join us. I'd love for you all to be multipliers so that you can get your, you know, friends, your sisters, your mothers, your brothers, whoever is an educator into this world.
Yeah, Coco goes, I'm in. We're all in, Vriti. Awesome. You still, we're in. We're in. All right. What about you, Shylesh? Why don't you share with us? I think somebody has some noise going on. I'm not sure if it's Ian or who. Just speak if you can put yourself on mute. Shylesh, why don't you share your project with us?
Yep. 1 week, please. So before sharing my screen, I'll just give you an idea of what this project is about. It's a P2E game. So you play, the entry point is an NFT token. You play the game and then you make rewards. The rewards could be in the company token or the game token, or it can also be of any other standard tokens. So that is still in talks, but yeah, I'm happy to share whatever the progress I've made till now. So I'm just going to quickly.
So this is about cricket. Hold on. This is about cricket, guys, for all of us from the West Indies here.
Okay.
Yep, we can see your screen.
You can see my presentation?
Yes, we can. We can.
Okay. Awesome. So the project is called NPL. It's called, the abbreviation is NFT Premier League. So since I'm from India and I kind of follow a lot of cricket, I wanted to make a game around cricket. Most of the games around cricket are on fantasy and betting, and also turn-based and card games. There's no such game which is on real play, multiplayer. So we don't have any IPs of any cricketers as of now, but let's say if things goes well, we might also get somebody on board.
Hold on, we can send you. We can send you Brian Lara from Trinidad and Tobago. Oh,
nice. Love the Caribbean players as well.
Yeah.
So that's about a small idea about what the game is about. So right now, what I am doing is we are raising funds, and we have a team of designers, like say illustrators, animators, and game developers, and also blockchain developers. We are trying to make this game live as soon as possible. I don't want to launch the NFTs before the game, because that's going to give some amount of wait time for the community. So basically, I just want to launch them all at once. So September, July to September is when I'm planning to launch this event. The NFT and the game. So let me get you through the design and the idea of it. So NFT, you play. So basically, we wanted to start a game with our own token to control the whole ecosystem. But apparently at this moment, it's a trial and error. And so we will be using some tokens like Matic and Ethereum as of now, and then later on move on to our own token, which we'll be calling it as NPL. And if to show you a glimpse of our cricketer, this is how a cricket character would look. It would have a level. So the cricketers can be leveled up all the way till 100. So right now we'll be launching 5,000 cricketers who will be of common, not rare. We'll be launching rare and also celebrity really soon. But right now we'll be launching common with a level 1 and with different types of player skill set. That is going to directly impact your gameplay. Can you guys see the
cricket? So hold on, Shylesh, just so I can understand. Yeah. So technically, if I want to play cricket, I can go buy an NFT of one of the players, and I get to be in the game, correct?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Correct. Okay, but what if I really don't know how to play cricket? Like, what happens then?
That's when the gameplay comes in the picture. I'll show you the gameplay. Okay. It's very simple. Okay. There's a couple of buttons. You keep tapping them, and then you would.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure.
Can you guys see the NFT cricketers?
Yes, we can. Yeah. We can see the cricketers.
So there are two types of NFTs which are going to be here. The one is going to be an ERC-721, which is your non-fungible token. So each character will have its own traits and metadata in the blockchain, which can be upgraded based on your gameplay. Let's say you want to upgrade to level 10. You have to spend some money and then change the skill set of the token. This is going to be your second NFT token, which is going to be an ER-1155, which is a collection of, it's a group token. So it's a fungible token. So multiple people can own the same token. So this is the secondary NFT token, which we'll be launching, which is going to add value to the primary one and also to the gameplay. So let's say you have a helmet. You can take a lot of fastballs hit on your head. So something like that. So if you have a shoe which has a certain level of endurance, you can have a better run rate, things like that. So this is your the complete gameplay. You have a left and right button, which is very simple. Right now you're looking at the bowler, and there's a small control there on the right side. You pick your ball and then you just keep throwing them. So that's the only button there on the right side. You have to hit it as soon as you feel whatever ball you want to throw. So you take turns. It's a 6-ball game. You take turns batting and bowling. So the batsman kind of sets a target, and the bowler, when he gets on the pitch, he kind of chases the target. So that's how this gameplay works. We also have passive gameplay or a passive income stream, where you can own a stadium and then you can rent it off for a game. Let's say you own one stadium, or one stadium can be owned by 100 other people or 1,000 other people, which could be an ERC-1155 token, and which could be rented out for a game, right? So things like that is also possible. We're still trying to explore the idea. I'm going to give you a glimpse of what are the characters we have right now. We have around 5,000 different characters generated. We're also adding.
Why are there no girl? Why are there no women on here?
Soon, yeah. I don't have the bandwidth as of now, so let me get more people.
What do you mean? What do you need bandwidth to have women cricketers? Come on, Shailesh.
And there are many women cricketers.
We planned it to be launched in the second phase with another 10,000 or 20,000 odd NPL. Depends on the reception, by the way. So we will be launching it too. We have a lot of female cricketers here in India. I want to capitalize on that crowd as well. So yeah, why not?
Okay.
So what the next steps we'll be having is I'm trying to raise funds. I already have somebody backing me right now as an angel investor. So he'll be backing me till a year. So I need to find out, and I'm also going to pitch a couple of crypto companies. Like I have a schedule with Polygon Studio, so that they're actually giving out a lot of funds for play to e game segment. So that's going to be help, some form of help for me to kickstart the project. And not just Polygon, a couple of other players are also doing that. So that'll be of help. So you can follow our Discord. I'll put it on the chat. You guys can have a look at our community. It's basically cricket. If you're into cricket, you might like it. We have around 5,000 people on Twitter. You might also look follow our Twitter handle.
Thank you. So that's really awesome. So we've just seen, guys, two completely different NFT projects. And what about you, Ian? Do you want to share with us a particular design project, something that, whether it's for yourself or for a client, that you're working on that's kind of cool? We can't hear you. You're on mute. Okay.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can.
I suppose this is going to highlight the difference or the different possibilities of the NFT space, because I'm not working on any NFT project specifically for myself. Mostly what I do is just develop NFTs for clients who can't really do it for themselves. Think about it this way. Selling artwork has always been around for ages. Back in the days, what people used to do is they used to commission artists to paint something, and then they can have it in their homes and maybe resell it at a later date. And so that's the service I provide. I'm the artist that's for hire. So for me, I'm actually working on projects outside of the NFT space, but I'm using the NFTs to fund those projects, which is something that was not available before. What I like about the Web 3.0 that Shayla, that's her name, I kind of butchered it. She had mentioned earlier that Web 3.0 is the future, and it's something that we need to take seriously, because they're not calling it Web 3 maybe. They're not saying that it's a forecast or something can happen. They're calling it 3.0, which is the number that comes after 2, which means that the government, everyone is pushing resources into Web 3, meaning that it's something we have to take seriously in terms of it'll change the way that we interact completely online. And we're seeing that from big companies, especially if Facebook lost, almost $250 billion in their metaverse platform. And so what I'm doing is I'm trying to solve other problems, and the NFT is helping me to do that, something that I couldn't do before. And as an artist, what I love about the NFT space is that we are giving room to freely think about how we want to create the art, even when a client contacts us, because most clients don't even know what they want. They just know that they have a purpose. They have a utility for their the NFT. For example, I was contacted by someone in the sporting industry who wanted to create NFT for female athletes in sports. And so what you find is that these clients, they have the utility, they have the audience, they have the purpose. What they just lack is the artist and the developer to make that happen. And what I noticed with, is it Vishri? I'm sorry, I'm saying
Vriti, 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 yeah, Vriti, yes.
And I mean that, I'm supposed to get this correct.
Yeah.
What she had mentioned earlier about the Web 3.0 is that it's helping so many people do projects, especially, what I was going to say is her artwork, I was looking at it and it's really amazing. I don't know how you got that quality there, but I can tell you, it'll make you pull your hair out just to get that kind of quality there. And she was right when she said that just pulling off one simple NFT project is not very simple. Any art project is not as straightforward as running a company, because most of the times when you're developing art, you don't know anything, because it's just the artist there trying to figure out how to make something nice, something that you have like 10 billion ideas that you can't explain, and they have to somehow make that into an NFT that you can market. And so my advice usually to everyone who's getting into the NFT space, you can make the most beautiful artwork, you can come up with the best utility, but it really comes down to one thing and one thing only, it's marketing. You have to spend your time getting to know the people that you're going to be selling these things to, the utility behind these things, and getting people on board. Because at the end of the day, these are just digital things that people don't need to live with. They just choose to live with. And as such, it's not impossible to sell. It's just that I think any NFT project failed just because the people behind it just didn't do their homework, or maybe they just had fantasies about what the NFT space is about. Who are buying it are they believe that somehow this is going to make their lives better, and it can make their lives better if the project is executed wholeheartedly in the direction to make things better. And so as an artist, I'm happy to help clients to do that. Hopefully that answers your question.
Perfect. You did answer the question. So now here's what we're going to do. We're going to have two breakout rooms. Ian, I'm going to put you with Vriti so you learn her name. So you and Vriti are going in one breakout room and Shylesh is going in the other breakout room. We're going to divide up the crowd and you're going to have your audience help you solve one issue that you're having in launching your NFT. This is where you really get to know your audience. So any one thing that you want their brains, their collective brains on, that you're trying to figure out in your launch, let the community help you do that. So Naima, can we divide everybody up into two breakout rooms? Ian is going with Vriti and Shylesh is going on his own, and they're going to help you solve one issue, and you're going in the breakout room for 6 minutes, guys. Okay, are we back, everyone? So Vriti, why don't you share with us, what did everybody help you on?
Yeah, so we actually were having some mic issues and internet issues. So the introductions actually took most of the time, but at the very end, folks, so my question was, how do we get this NFT into the hands of people who really care about improving education, even if they're not an educator? And one person suggested reaching out to parents and activating that community, which was really great. And then the second comment was actually unfortunately cut off because we only had 53 seconds left.
Okay, that's okay. So more time. You needed more time, basically. Sure. You need more time. But anyone can put comments in for Vriti in reference to how does she activate in terms of that teacher community. Vriti, there is a community called, I'm sure you're aware of it, Teachers Pay Teachers. That's a pretty big community. So many of those types of communities might be great communities to partner with, because that's kind of the watering holes of where a lot of teachers are hanging out and because they all go there for lesson plans.
Yeah, the former CEO of Teachers Pay Teachers is on our board, so we're pretty good with communities like that.
But awesome.
It's a little hard to get into them, to be honest, because they're a little superficial, but
what about for you, Shylesh? What did the community solve for you?
I got a couple of valid points, like add the other gender as well onto the game, and a couple of marketing tips as well. So I think it's a little far-fetched for me to get this done right now. But apparently, I will be doing that as soon as
Okay. So collective wisdom, guys, you know, that's one of the wonderful things about the GLEAC community and, you know, our Slack chats and all kinds of stuff is that sometimes we limit stuff to the four corners of our own brain when the collective wisdom of somebody who knows nothing about our space, but they immediately can see some kind of parallel universe to be able to pinpoint and go, oh, have you ever thought of that? And you're like, no, not in a million years would I have even seen that. So I always kind of encourage that to everyone, you know, to just step into communities that don't have anything to do with what you're doing, because sometimes they can just look at stuff and show you hidden and blind spots and hidden areas that you were not able to see. So quick question, I'm going to ask, Ian, are you minting any of NFTs for your clients or no?
Yeah.
You are. Okay. So what do you, why don't you give us, how do you mint an NFT in five steps? Up to five. So it might be less. Like if we wanted like a like, you know, a play sheet of what do you do? I've decided today in this, I'm going to mint an NFT. Like what's the first thing? What are five things that you need to do before you can mint an NFT?
All right. So to get a successful NFT project, there is actually two different aspects of this project. One is the development of the artwork and the actual selling of the artwork. How do you get people to buy it? Because
so let's not talk about the selling and the success. Let's talk about just getting it up.
So the five steps that I have involves actually minting the NFTs. And I would actually say that though, your first step should always be marked in even before you start your stuff, because you need to know if people want what you have to offer. And that is going to give you motivation in the production part of it, because the production aspect is going to be a bit grueling. You're going to be spending days there not seeing any artwork because it's not going to be in front of you and you have to have faith. So start remarketing, know there's an audience and go from there. After that, get your concept. You know, you need to know what your audience is, what they want, what they're going to connect with, and how you're going to conceptualize whatever the utility of your NFT will be. Because if you can't connect with your audience, and you're never going to be able to get an idea that, you know, meshes with your audience. So I would say that the next thing would do is to develop your concept. Don't overthink it also. You know, it doesn't have to be perfect. It's just something has to be able to mesh with your audience, because a lot of times if you say less, you actually connect more than if you try to push more into your artwork, you know. Like, chill out. Or relax, you'll get it done.
Chill out.
Art, you know, that's my best advice when it comes to art, because you have, art is not something, it's not deductive reasoning. Art is like a flower. You have to allow it, you have to nurture it with sunlight and knowledge and allow it to bloom.
Step three
would be get into the actual development part of the artwork. You're going to have to figure out what traits you want, what rarity levels, how does that connect with your audience, because some rarity might be very interesting. The same way Vishri set her rarity levels for her stuff. I hope you guys paid attention to that, because that's a really good example of how to set up an NFT project. And so you'll be, you know, having a conversation between you and the artist about what rarity levels that you want and how you're going to combine them. And then your artist is going to pretty much run the code to combine all the traits into the 10,000 or 3,000, how much ever NFT you want. And then the last step of that would be to either figure out if you're going to put that on a drop site or a marketplace. If you're going to have a private site, which is referred to as a drop site, you can allow your audience to pay the gas fee. And I know one of the questions you want to know is, what's the gas fee? The gas fee is just basically a tax.
I didn't even ask that yet, Ian.
Say my points. I can't help
it. I'm kidding. Tell us what gas fees are. I'm kidding. I'm pulling your leg.
Yeah, it's just think about it as a tax to use the Ethereum network. If you don't want to pay the gas fee, there are alternatives like the Polygon network where you don't have to pay the gas fee. For example, depending on if you're going to publish 10,000 images by yourself to the marketplace, it's going to cost you an arm and a leg to pay the gas fees for those images. So if
like
you're
what?
Going to publish-
Like what? Like what? Like what does it cost? An example. Give us, is it $50 per image? Is it $100? Is it like, give us an example.
I can't remember. I think it's about $30 to $50, somewhere around that. So that about, multiply that by 10,000, you're not going to have a great day at the bank.
Okay, so that's like if I want to put it on OpenSea, right? Like what if I, correct?
That's if you want to put it on the Ethereum network, no matter the marketplace.
Okay, fine. Okay, cool.
And so there are marketplaces that allow you to have it on both the Ethereum and the Polygon network, like OpenSea, there are several others. And okay. So what you find people do is, for example, if I make 10,000 images and I just want to publish my my artwork or any artwork, and I don't want to pay the gas fees, then I would just publish it to the Polygon network. If people want to put it on the Ethereum network, somehow I think it has this value, like your artwork has more value than the Ethereum network. I think that's one perception. But if you want to do that, you can have it on a drop site where you have 10,000 images and people are allowed to buy about 3 to 5 NFTs from you, and they would pay the gas fees, because for 3 to 5 images, that's not a lot of money.
Okay, cool. All right, Vriti, what about you? How do you mint an NFT in 5 steps? Do you have different steps, same steps? What are your steps looking like?
The steps that I mentioned before are really it. So it's not, I mean, it depends, like there's really no purpose in minting an NFT that doesn't have significant thought behind it, unless you're doing it as an experiment. Or you're doing it just to sort of like learn. Like the first thing that I ever did before we created our collection, there's this thing called nftgenerator.art. Here, I'll pop it in the chat.
Yeah, and how long, Vriti, just so the audience knows, how long have you been working on your NFT project?
6 months.
6 months. So it's about 6 months to launch, correct?
Yeah, and it took about 4 months for our NFT 3D designer to actually develop this. So I'm the art director, but she's like the designer. And so, and I, my co-founder is also the art director. So the three of us together basically like ideated this thing, and then she actually designed it. We had 23 iterations of it first. And so the first 23 were terrible. And the 24th was like, okay, this is good. And so we went with it. So I would say like, if you want to experiment with the collection piece, which is like, how do you layer? Because most of these NFTs are collections that have random generated layers, so that you can have like 10,000 pieces that are randomly generated. You don't have to create 10,000 of them. And so what you do is you create many layers, like a hat and eyes and skin and hair, whatever. And then you create like 10 versions of each one of them. And then you just let a random generator put them all together. And so the one that I just dropped in the chat is the one I like to experiment with. You can generate 100 NFTs for free using as many, and it's super easy to use. And so you can like, I created my own NFTs that were really silly looking because I wanted to experiment with this thing first. So you can try doing that, and you can do it with kids. You can do it, you know, however you want. It's kind of fun.
Very cool. Very cool. All right. And what about you, Shylesh? Are there any 5 steps you have in minting your first NFT?
I would say there are enough, just 3 steps. You go to OpenSea, link your wallet, and then start minting.
Basics. Okay, very practical step. I love that.
Okay. I can share my screen. I can show you guys how to generate an artwork. If you have 2 minutes.
Yeah, let's show us. Why don't we see what you're up to? I'm going to stop sharing. Why don't you show us how to generate some artwork here? Isn't it interesting how the same question has like completely different answers from where your point of view is? Yes. Okay, we're here. Oh, look at that.
Have a look at this. So you have multiple layers, and then you have multiple grids. If you look at this corner, it gives you an idea of what you will be getting. And then once you hit export, you get the metadata and the number of collections you want. So let's say I want to go for 5,000. I can do 5,000 if I want to do 100. Just click on generate, and then it's done. It's so simple. And then you get it as a compressed file. You have to extract it, and then you get your artwork. Simple. And then you put this on.
What's the collection size for?
Collection size.
What was that number you put?
Yeah, so this one is the previous one I did. Like today, I was running an experiment. I got some Caribbean players today, so I wanted to try them out.
Hold on, Shylesh, did I inspire that?
No, I... No.
You could have said yes, Sal. You inspired me to go. You could have completely like scored some bonus points, Shylesh.
Absolutely right. I actually had this in mind when I wanted to do that. So you get all these trades separately done. And then I have a Caribbean player done. So I just working on the external bits like the accessories, hairstyle, eyewear, stuff like that. So I'm working on this now. It's very simple, guys. It's very simple. Trust me, it won't take you more than 5 minutes to.
Yeah, but that's, I mean, but certainly not in terms of, you know, getting what you want it to look like, right? So I think it's once as you generate it, once as you figure out what your layers are and what you actually want, it becomes easy to generate 10,000 of it, but it's the figuring out what you actually want that original set to look like that requires a lot of thought and effort. Okay, so I think Vriti answered this question. How long does it technically take to mint an NFT and how do you prepare beforehand so it goes smoothly? Is there anything you want to add on this, Vriti, that you've learned in preparing for this launch of something you could do beforehand, you know, preparing for it to go smoothly?
I think what Ian said before, which is like, make sure you know what your marketing plan is. I think that's the biggest thing, like regardless of what your NFT is, what your utility is, it's, if it's the most wonderful thing on the planet, if you don't have a good marketing plan, it's never going to get sold. And so I would say marketing is the most important thing. Yeah, so obviously have a good product, don't have a shitty product, but also like, you know, the marketing is really important.
Okay, and I'm going to ask this question and I'm going to ask it to Shylesh. Have you ever designed, I'm gonna start with this and we're gonna end on this question one more. Have you ever designed an NFT that went south? Nobody bought it. And what were the learnings from all of it? You go, Shylesh.
I actually experimented a lot before getting onto this. OpenSea was had a paid version earlier. I kind of paid 0.1 Ethereum some 1 year back, 1-2 years back. So the Kong you see on the right was a failed project. So we spent a lot of time making that. We spent like say 2 weeks of time just to sketch it out and then make different trades for it. But apparently it went south. So that's when I figured out the best thing is like you have to make a community before and you have to create some of a hype before getting onto this project. And the other problem with OpenSea back then was they only had Ethereum network, they didn't have Polygon. So the gas fees was really high. Let's say you're selling a product for 0.1 Ethereum, the gas fees, depending on that network condition, it might be cheaper or it might be expensive, even expensive than your artwork itself. So that was a good learning curve for me. So it kind of went south. I think one or two people bought it. I'm feeling sorry for the people who bought it now. So yeah, that's how it went.
Okay. So this is not going to be a breakout room. This is going to final thing. I want you guys in chat, everybody, take 1 minute and come up with one cool idea for an NFT collection with some utility and perks associated with them. In chat, let's go. 1 minute, I'll put some music on for you guys. Okay, everyone, I'm going to share some of these incredible ideas. So Coco, food from different countries with discounts, free food, meet the chef on cooking workshops from different F&B outlets. Well, you know, food is always a good thing, right, Coco? Unique NFTs where people experience copying. I imagine you can get students to use NFTs for their assignments so they can't pay someone to do it for them. Oh, I love that. You could also use it as a form of patent to some extent, anything you like. Yeah, an NFT instead of the traditional patent law, you're right. I'm thinking of a collection of sounds that make a song that plays for 1,000 years. A certificate for a module that gives access to meetups and coaching sessions. World history, travel and tourism. I already have one, I'm working on it. Yash, making India's original practices of meditation technique and mental wellness techniques available to people 24/7 across the world. Knowledge sharing series. Do you see all of you have an NFT in you? Every single one of you here, right? Every single one of you have something. So here's how I would like to end on, you know, in terms of this nerd. First of all, I want to thank our incredible speakers. you know, Vriti, Ian, for really sharing and Shylesh their stories with us. Here, you know, the thing about NFTs, guys, is that nobody here can say I've been an expert in the space for the last 5 or 10 years. Everybody is tinkering in the space, and you can only tinker in the space by going and trying and experimenting. So my challenge to every single one of you here is to either go and, you know, set a little budget like I did with my team, under $25, go and buy your first NFT and figure out why you're buying it. Is it just the art? Is there a utility? Is there some other reason? Or better yet, create and mint your own NFT and come to us as a community and share it with us. You now have a community with us, you know, by just being here. So I encourage all of you to keep coming to our events, you know, wholeheartedly. I mean, it's an absolute privilege to have all of you here. As always, please let our speakers know, Vriti, with, I want to see with tingly fingers. So the more movement means the more you learned. How much did you learn from our, look at Lorraine, how much did you learn from our speakers today? Show them with your tingly fingers, guys. There we go. Yeah, we learned, guys. Thank you. Wholeheartedly, Vriti, wholeheartedly, huge success on your launch. Shylesh, huge success on your launch. Anyone who is looking to figure out to design, Ian is your guy. Good night. And thank you guys so much for joining us. An absolute privilege, as always. Bye. See you at our next event. Ya callé, lo mismo soy yo. No tengo...